Airskeet, so they're focusing on ManCloud. But as has been proven so many times, you can't ban out ManCloud. He has got a giant pool of champions.
Exactly. He can pull out whatever he wants. He's run Ezreal in the mid lane before. We've seen a couple of these guys start pulling out the double AD carry strategy and run Ezreal in there. There's a lot to pull from, but sure, you remove the biggest playmakers. Ahri is one of the, I would say, sort of easiest to make plays with because she's so mobile. You get the three dashes. You can lock someone up as well. And you just tend to eat supports for breakfast. You kind of one-shot them and create opportunities. So the fact that Mineski's banning it, though, and not picking it as blue team is a little bit worrisome, and it tells me they've either got a completely different first pick option or they just can't play it.
Interesting. So picks and bans continue to fly through. Zed continuing to be, I believe, 100% banned out in this tournament so far. Obviously, yeah. So many strong Zed players. Nobody wants to let that one through. Sona also being taken away as well as Lee Sin taken away from Kaigu. Corki being banned out. Probably one of the strongest AD carries, although Hogmore's put him in a good couple of appearances. So picks coming in.
Yeah.
Shen straight away from Mineski. So we're going to see Snorri on Shen. But it looks like Elise is going to get picked for Miffy.
This gives a lot of opportunities for Vulcan.
I should say ex-Miffy, not Miffy, because we've got ex-Miffy and Miffy in this tournament.
Yeah, you got to be careful about all those. So the Shen coming in is just a really good standard pick. It'll work with pretty much anything going on. That you can run actually heavy dive comp with champions like Vi, which Smithy likes to run, or you know, a Twitch for the AD carry for the submarine strategy, or just a standard default split push to protect the hyper carry in the late game. A lot of those options are available here for Shen. On the other side, for Vulcan, they've actually opted for an ambiguous jungle top lane pick. Some guys even play mid lane Zyra. It's not one that I know ManCloud for, but you never know. But Zyra, a great bottom laner there, one of the two that Bloodwater loves to play outside of Sona, and it gives a lot of backline control as well as follow-up for hard engage teams.
So the pick's still waiting on Mineski, 20-second countdown. They're certainly taking their time, making sure that you make the full use of it. Nocturne potentially coming out, yes, again. So we saw Nocturne used by Mineski earlier on in the groups. Obviously, it hasn't worked too well because they're still 0-3, but Thresh also getting locked in.
Well, I like Nocturne being picked up alongside Shen, though. It allows Mineski to actually dive into the backline and wreak havoc and kill Zuna. If he plays Ashe, which has been actually a pretty popular champion for him of late, he doesn't have good escape tools. He's pretty easy to jump on him with the Shen and Nocturne. And interestingly enough, for what it's worth, Twist of Fate is still available. You might see the triple global come out. You never know.
Absolutely. Just shrinking down, guys. Don't worry. I got this covered. We're ready for the next few picks for Vulcan.
We're good. Is this better?
Absolutely. Wonderful. Thank you very much, Freak. Tried to sneak that one through, but they weren't letting me production quickly swinging back onto me. So Caitlyn potentially going to come out here. And alongside Karthus for ManCloud, we haven't seen a Karthus so far in this tournament, so this could be an interesting pick. ManCloud, of course, as you mentioned earlier, able to play anything.
Yeah, so I actually like the two picks they grab here. The Caitlyn, they realize that Nocturne Shen is so good at diving onto the back line. And actually, in the North American regional against Curse, he said, give me Kog'Maw, I can outplay Shen Nocturne, it's no big deal. This time around, he's like, you know what? I'm just going to play Caitlyn and be safer here and survive in the back line. And ManCloud picking up Karthus denies the sort of, what are the third global options you would see here for Mineski? Again, Twisted Fate still available, or picking up Teleport still available for them. But removing one of the globals, also having one of their own for Vulcan to counteract some of those ganks, it's an important pickup here.
Tristana potentially could make the first appearance, but no, going back to Varus instead. Which actually, you know, Varus we haven't seen a great deal of either this tournament, whereas coming into the lead up to this, was a big champion pick for every team.
Yeah, it's the crowd control. It's actually a sort of a very European pick, more so than North Americans, because a lot of the flashy AD carries there play carry-oriented AD carries, whereas as opposed to the utility-based ones. But this is a good setup here because they've added Ryze for damage output. I wouldn't have liked Varus and TF on the same team because there's not enough threat. There's not enough damage output. But now you can have Shen and Nocturne dive in there. You've got the follow-up from Thresh, the follow-up from Varus. Everyone's crowd-controlled, and Ryze just throwing abilities out there. And when you've got a champion like Karthus, who doesn't really threaten the Ryze in any way, Ryze gets to farm. And then if you actually gank with Nocturne, Ryze has some lockdown and can kill the Karthus off in a duel. So this actually gives a pretty good matchup to Mineski in the mid lane. When Nocturne hits 6, there's a dive potential in the mid lane. And when Shen hits 6, there's another dive potential as well.
So fast on-the-spot prediction for Sid here. What's he taking in that top lane?
Nasus would be a good one. It's just kind of a good sort of passive laner against Shen, who's going to scale better ultimately. Honestly, it's been the sort of type of champion he's been playing. Kennen's also a very good one-on-one matchup. Kennen beats Shen straight up, has stuns to break out the teleport as well. On the other side, he could also be a jungler picked up. that could also have been Elise the entire time for the top lane.
Well, it was the first choice he went with. Nasus in that top lane. We saw him playing it against Fnatic. Didn't really get a great use out of it because, as he mentioned himself, I was off the side guy. I was doing a great job. I was split pushing everybody. I was doing a great job.
He was basically the insurance policy because no one ever touched him. He was spamming that siphoning strike. He had a lot, and I wish I had the number on hand, but it was in the 400s.
It was
on a moderately short game. He was a very stacked Nasus. If a team fight had to break out later on, he could have two-shotted people, so that would have been all right. But again, he was the insurance policy. His team won without him. That is looking like Nasus right now, by the way. He's got Teleport and Ghost for Summoner spells. Mm-hmm. He's swapped onto the Nasus, and that matchup is good because he can 1v2 and survive, and he can survive and actually thrive in 1v1 because there's no kill threat from a Shen.
So while these teams are spawning, let's see who exactly you guys at home think is going to win this matchup. And according to you guys at home, it is going to be Vulcan, of course. 81% of you will think that Vulcan will be bouncing back and picking up a victory.
And of course, the analysts all agree with you guys. So the standings aren't going anywhere, whether we all got it wrong or right. Crepo, unfortunately, is still the worst among us. But just so you guys know, you're on a 7-game winning streak. You guys have predicted 7 games in a row correctly. So this is your number 8, which will make you legendary.
That's quite impressive. That's quite impressive considering, you know, how strong these groups have, especially Group B. I mean, you just think of the teams that are in this group right now. Nobody really could guess who is in there. Mm-mm. It's definitely all open. So the game about to come in there. What do we think we're going to see from this one? Mineski have gone behind early in a couple of these games. They need to try and hold out that lane phase longer against Vulcan.
So this is the interesting thing, is Mineski's actually got some good late game security in Ryze. He will be pretty hard to kill by the Vulcan lineup. None of them can really assassinate him. And he's got good scaling and good damage output. Also, they're the team able to make plays. They've got Thresh and Varus for a lot of crowd control, and Shen and Nocturne to dive in. These guys, the Filipino team, can really start fights and wreak havoc, which is, I think, where they really want to get things going. Get an early game lead, because we've seen them team fight well. Even from behind, they team fight well. So they get ahead, they're going to team fight phenomenally.
Well, you definitely know they're going to be diving in there. They've got that horrible combo of Nocturne and Shen leaping onto someone, so there's a potential for multiple members all in the same place. Yume already taking damage in that mid lane from Mancloud.
That's kind of unfortunate. He'll be able to survive. It's not that big of a deal. The one thing that might gum up the works is that Xmithie on Elise, that is a very good jungler early on. And you can never count any lane out. Even the passivest of lanes like Shen versus Nasus, you can turn that into a kill when Elise shows up. So you've always got to keep your eye out where Xmithie is going because he'll be able to make plays.
So it doesn't look like there's going to be anything crazy happening early on here. The two teams are setting themselves up, and this is conducive of what we've seen throughout most of the tournament so far. Nothing crazy in the invades. It's just either been a simple trade, which or late invades. We haven't seen a great deal of full-on aggression. The one time we did, it backfired horribly.
Yeah,
and it was Fnatic, I believe, against Vulcan.
That one was really, really rough. That was actually a trade that Vulcan just did a better job of turning around. Lemon Dogs tried one in their game against SK Telecom, and they had a decent start, but they ended up burning summoners for not much damage. It was the later ganks that snowballed ahead. But yeah, here we are. Both teams able to check brushes really well with spiderlings or lay waste and that kind of stuff. So typical setup. But what matters now is actually what the lane matchups end up being. It's Zuna and Bloodwater 2v1ing the Shen. It's Psycho Cid stuck in 1v2 against Exo and TG. And I'm going to say it again. I like Nasus in this matchup. I think he'll be able to survive very, very well and just get levels and then duel later on.
He is going to be getting the experience. Didn't obviously take the blue, but instead, that means the blue was given across the Mancloud in that mid lane.
I actually like this a lot because Ryze has a rough time last hitting under turret when his mana pool is limited and the base damages and cooldowns are pretty weak early on in the game. So Mancloud gets to shove really hard as Karthus, put Yume under his turret, and make him miss early last hits.
So Mythi looking at going for an invade here on towards that blue buff of itself. We're going to see it eventually. There it is. Smithy didn't manage to get it. Kaigu taking a lot of damage. It did mean that he has got that double buff, but he was forced to back away. So Smithy desperately trying to get in there. Is he going to try and create any plays? There is that ward in that top lane. So already Snoy pushed well against that tower. We're expecting this from the 2v1 lanes.
And look what just happened in the mid lane as well. Yume missed every single last hit there underneath the turret because Mancloud is just shoving and trying to ruin his day. This is going to be the order of the day. And until Nocturne hits level 6 or gets amazing positioning, he won't threaten Karthus at all. In fact, Kaigu's just defending the top lane, keeping Shen afloat.
And with that blue buff, he can just keep on hitting that lay waste on him all day long. Kaigu and Snoy having to help out this top lane. Does mean, of course, that down the bottom, I mean, this is expected. Sid's going to be slow, late behind there, but he should be able to hold on fine.
The interesting thing I've seen with Sid is actually, last time he did this, he actually learned Wither at level 3, okay, just to have a little bit of crowd control. Normally, you actually want to see rank 2 Spirit Fire, just because you have more minion clearing. There's the Wither again. So he actually has a little bit less turret protection than you would normally see from this. But what's up here for Smithy, though, is they had seen Nocturne for a while. He should be counter-jungling and slowing down that Nocturne level 6.
Yeah, he's just passed down that Blue Wolf ward. So they know that he's heading towards that middle, which is why you see Mancloud already stepping away a little bit here. He's not been shoving quite so hard on the tower. Still up there, but fairly aggressive. So we may see a play here from Mineski.
Now with Mancloud shoving that much, you've got the opening. Smithy's going to turn around. He'll walk over ward, getting spotted. There's the Rune Prison.
He managed to get the Rune Prison on the tower, but he flashes just in time before that Fear Leash went off. And Kaigu now gets caught out. There's going to be the cocoon on towards him. He's taking a hell of a lot of damage here. Will it be enough? Yes, it will. First blood will come in. It's Smithy that takes it.
That was a belated flash by Kaigu. The Fear Tether had already broken. He showed up too late, and the exhaust from Mancloud also helped create a little bit more distance than I think the Nocturne was expecting. Great counter gank of Force by Smithy. He'd actually already run toward the mid lane because he's, oh, okay, Nocturne's on this side. He will look for mid. Mancloud baited out.
So Smithy immediately follows that up, takes away those large wraiths, and the pressure in that mid lane was so strong that, well, Mancloud's gone back, and you can see the gulf developing here. The fact that he got that blue buff early on, the fact that he's just been pressuring, is 13 to 35 CS. Massive difference, and it's already 600 gold advantage just 5 minutes in.
Yep, and even though the blue buff is timing out right now, the fact that Mancloud has Tear and a Doran's Ring means he can just keep shoving. And after that basically double buff transfer, the bad gank in the top lane, it's going to be fighting a Snoy first.
And Snoy is going to go down. There's no way he's surviving this one. Normally, it's very hard to dive that Shen, but the three-man Vulcan team knew exactly what they were doing there.
It's Nocturne heading up to the top lane to try to soak up some experience, but you never know. Vulcan might just dive him.
He may just turn this one around. The turret's going to go down very soon, so Kaigu can't stay too close to this one. We see the repel come out from Smithy. Going to be throwing out that cocoon in a moment. He's waiting for that spell shield to be burnt out. There it is. He lands the cocoon in there. He's going to sink his fangs in. He's going to put a lot of damage on Kaigu, forcing him back away to base.
So none of that experience ended up going to Nocturne. He's still only level 4, doesn't have his buffs, he won't be able to farm very quickly. So that paranoia gank that we were looking for, the Stand United from Shen, those aren't coming in for a very long time. Vulcan could force a dragon before any of those globals come up.
Sid taking a lot of damage in this bottom lane. You can see the turret already being taken pretty low as well. Exo almost out of mana, and the rest of Vulcan, they are already transferring themselves down to that bottom lane. I'm not too sure whether they're going to get there before that tower goes, which is what Sid's just realized. That's why he's sticking around just a little bit longer.
And it really depends on how powerful Zuna and Bloodrunner will be in this lane. The Wither on Exo, that actually makes, now that I think about it, that's great. It lowers the turret damage output to keep it alive a bit longer. Yeah, it's going to go down anyway. So that actually makes sense now on the Wither, now that I see him use it to keep the turret alive. But Sid's going to have teleport in about a minute. They don't need him for the dragon fight just because of the big item and level lead here for Vulcan. But if they wanted to wait for it, they could just kind of abuse the teleport.
Looking in this mid lane, you can see Mancloud's taken a lot of damage actually from Yume, it seems. So Yume bursting out on towards him. But Vulcan, look at this. Dragon control just coming up to the 7 minute mark is almost certainly going to get taken. There it is, secured by Vulcan. That continues to stretch their gold lead. They're up to 2,000 now, just 7 minutes in.
And look at the number of wards these guys have bought up. Three of them were just carrying wards. Zuna just put one down in his tribe rush, helping to let Bloodwater build towards the Sightstone earlier on. Of course, you're seeing wards on Psycho Sid as well. And he's going to have to ward up his top lane to make sure he can watch for ganks on that same merit. But now Sid is level 6. He's got rank 3 Siphoning Strike. And here's a Shen donating him a bunch of minion waves. And here comes that Psycho Sid sitting in the top lane getting Siphoning Strike.
See, he's just going to farm it up. He's going to be sat there pretty much the whole game getting that Q built up. As he said, I was doing something. I was keeping the pressure on that top lane. And often, you know, when there is a top lane and he's just been left on that island, he does probably feel like he's just playing his own game.
I think that's why he got the name Psycho Sid. Actually, he's been left alone so much. He's got a little bit crazy up there. And just his only solace is Siphoning Strike stacks. He's like, yeah, I've got 80 now. Uh-huh. Yeah, he wants to. And that's what's going on in his head right now.
I was starting to wonder where that was going there, Freak, I gotta be honest. But I'm glad you ended it off there. Yume is gonna be taking away that blue buff. And the blue buff, of course, was given across to Mancloud. So Mancloud, looking like he's gonna take those wolves and transfer down to that bottom lane. We do see Zuna and Bloodwater pushing in this mid lane, so they're gonna try and keep pressure on there. TG was coming up to try and help out. But he is going to be passing straight into that wall of pain from Mancloud. Mancloud going to keep the pressure on. He has got flash available. It may well require it because Mancloud's not going to give up the waste chase on here. Just managed to get the lay waste down. Ace in the hole coming out. Mancloud caught out there. Great chain of corruption from Exo, but the exhaust just timely. He's going to flash through. Gets the kill on towards Mancloud. Zuna in trouble around the backside. He's going to get taken down. We're going to see the Requiem landing. He's not going to find his target. Now they're going to get the lock up on Bloodwater. Bloodwater tries to get the kill. He's got his passive available, but that's a third kill for Mineski. And Vulcan just completely caught out in the river.
And Psycho Sid did not teleport down. The globals are a little bit easier to access here for Mineski. They were able to dive in and turn that around. That is exactly what their team comp wants to do. Hit level 6, get a battle, everyone show up.
So Mineski now in charge, pushing down this bottom lane. They are going to back away from it, but that's going to give them a giant confidence boost. And you can see Kaigu feeling that confident. He's getting in towards Exmithia's jungle, taking away his minions because Exmithia himself is taking away that lane and really keeping the pressure on towards Vulcan.
It's always an intelligent choice, and it's what we actually see from the counter junglers is they typically do it once they know where the enemy jungler is. You don't want to run into a 1v2 and be like, surprise, I'm in your territory and outnumbered. You wait till you see the enemy jungler and start poaching camps away. Take the big golem, take the big wraith, take the big wolf. And then when the enemy jungler walks around, he's like, oh, I got this lane experience, but I'm missing out on jungle XP, and it puts you ahead. So smart choices there by Kaigu. But here comes the cooldown period, because the globals are now down for Mineski. The thing is, they'll be back up in time for Dragon, so that's not even a big issue. You just won't see them play aggressive for a little while.
So, difference of items. We've seen so many Trinity Falls stacked out this time from the AD carries. This time around, doesn't look like it's going to happen.
No. Looks like it's going to be the standard Infinity Edge build here for Zuna. He realizes, okay, I'm going to go for that late game. That's always been Zuna's style, really, is play for the late game, build an Infinity Edge, do a bunch of damage overall. Exo, that's actually a Bloodthirster build. It's the more caster-based Varus build that we see more often. You can go Infinity Edge. It's still good. You actually have roughly the same damage output as a Caitlyn. You're just less safe. But he wants to deal a bunch of burst, snipe people with piercing arrows, do a bunch of burst damage with the hail of arrows as well. So it's just a different style. He'll be doing plenty of damage, though.
And talk to me about Exmithy. Psycho Sid, because he's gone straight for that Negatron Cloak, and really the only magic damage is coming from Yume, and he just doesn't care about Snoy in that split lane.
Yeah, that was actually a specifically Vulcan looking to fight Snoy. We've actually seen teams see someone go for an early Negatron Cloak and swap their dual lane into him to kill him with the physical damage of the AD carry. Psycho Sid needs to fight Shen to survive any of those matchups, but he knows that's exactly where Mineski wanted to put Shen, because the global, you want to put it as far away from the dragon as possible.
Mm-hmm. So we do see Vulcan stacking for a potential gank down the bottom. Exmithy has snuck into this bush unseen, but it does seem that Kaigu is within ultimate range. Hasn't got it quite available just yet. We'll be up in a couple of seconds. You can see Vulcan already putting the pressure down. The hook on towards Zuna pulls him into the tower. He is going to go down. There's no doubt about that. Stranglethorns will not save him.
Hitting a hook like that is so important. Getting the plays, opening them up, lanterning someone in, starting the fight. That is what this team wants to do. And now the globals are coming back up. Mineski can make another play and secure a dragon if they get the right opening.
Sid just shows himself down this middle lane, goes back towards the top. There's nothing to be gained from continuing that shove on that top lane at the moment because Snoy is pushed right against his tower. Seeing if he could gain anything on Yume, scare him away from that lane. But as it stands, Mineski are leading in the kills, 4-2. This is more kills than they've had, I believe, in the tournament. I don't believe they've hit that 4 mark. Oh, I tell a lie, they got the ace on Samsung Galaxy Ozone just earlier on today. But this is the first time they've had the kill lead in the tournament, that's for sure. And actually, in terms of gold, despite the fact they're one dragon down, they're only 100 gold difference.
Yeah, they've tied the turrets equally, and it is that kill lead. It really is what it comes from. And actually, look at what Exo's been doing. When we first started the tournament, we said that Exo was the guy to watch, that he had done a very good job during the SEA regional. And you look at him, 104-93, has a minion kill lead over Zuna, despite Vulcan being the team trying to dictate the pace and trying to make a lot of the early moves and lane swaps. So Exo, with a finished Bloodthirster in time for Dragon, that is an important power spike.
We'll see how that develops into that power, because we do see it. Dragon is up in just 5 seconds' time. Mineski are setting themselves up. Yume is going to go back and buy before he goes to it. They wants to complete that Rod of Ages, it seems. Looks like it's going to be his first item. So we do see the two supports actually heading towards that river. Looks like Vulcan, though, have that timing down. coming straight in. TG tries to sneak that ward in that corner, and Vulcan realizing it, they don't actually have a pink ward of their own to get on towards that dragon.
Yeah, they only have one kind of scooping off to the side, so they don't know for sure that Modesty can see them, but you've got to guess when you don't pink ward on top of the dragon, that's going to be available. The other interesting thing about the Modesty squad is they actually want to buy a little bit more time, because Exo just built the Bloodthirster, so he's still stacking it up. He's missing up to 30 attack damage for the next couple of minutes, and that's actually pretty important as far as team fighting well.
Yeah, so Vulcan, despite having the timing, they don't want to go for it. They're feeling a little bit more cautious suddenly on Modesty. Suddenly not so confident coming into this one. Sid taking some damage from Snoy with that Sunfire Cape. Ex-Mithy getting aggressed upon by Kaigu. Kaigu forced away from this one, though. Yume does come in, just got himself that blue buff completed. And look at Modesty. They are setting up for a potential dragon of their own.
They're definitely going to be able to, honestly, with the globals available, Ryze having his blue buff now, a finished Rod of Ages as well. That guy has not been shut down. It's a 2-0 Ryze. Here's the push in. They've got to realize, though, that Vulcan can see them go for this, and Nashus has teleport.
He has teleport. There is also Stand United available. Oh, that's going to be, I think it was just off the side. Ex-Mithy getting caught out completely. He's going to come in for this one. Doesn't get the steal. Instead tries to rappel away, but he's got nowhere to go. Zuna's going to get dived on by Kaigu, and instead it's a bit of a sloppy fight. But you do see a piercing arrow landing across. MacLeod getting involved. Gets himself straight up towards Yume. He goes down. Snoy gets the kill there, but this could be good turnaround from Vulcan. There's going to be the Requiem coming down. He manages to get one. It's going to be another going down as well. Sid comes across, and that is almost the ace coming out here. One more to go. Snoy turns around, gets the flash, gets down on towards X-Mini. Bloodweller taken low, but Psycho Sid with that wither should have enough to finish him off. He tries desperately to get on Bloodwater, but it's not going to happen. Wow, Kaigu, yeah, the only man to have survived.
But that's a 4-for-3, but with a dragon going over to Modesty. Let's watch this fight. Xmithy goes for the seal and doesn't get it. And now watch as the fight sort of starts out, but watch what Yume gets to do. He is a fed Ryze with blue buff. CC'd for a while, but gets to show back up. Mancloud blows up so fast. Unfortunately, Yume does get taken down in the back, but just watch Psycho Sid, though. He got teleported in and gets to wreak havoc. Chases down Exo, makes that kill happen with a siphoning strike. And really, these top laners on the island got to just sit there and wreak havoc in the back. While everyone's distracted, everyone's trying to fight everyone else, Psycho Sid and Snoy ran around, killed dudes in the back line, made everyone cry a little bit, and in the end, still a small gold lead for Modesty.
Kaigu taking a big chunk of damage there as well. So a 4-for-1 compared to a dragon means that the gold is actually still fairly close. Just 300 gold between them, you can see. And despite that massive farming lead that Mancloud had in that middle against Yume, so far it hasn't equated into too much damage from him. Did get good position in there, and it does mean the Vulcan are going to push on towards this mid lane turret.
And you can see a lot of damage in the Kaigu!
Oh, he's in the hole. He's going to get blocked off by Yume. This time around, it won't get the kill, but it will get them the tower.
That's important, though. Of course, the top lane turret got traded back, but Vulcan aren't done pushing mid.
They're not done yet. They're going to push on towards that inner turret. Sid's not going to allow them to back off either, so it's only going to be Yume protecting this one. So Vulcan should take themselves in. Just off the side, you can see Snoy is laying in wait. Is he going to go for it? It's going to be very ballsy play. You can see just coming from the back is Exo as well. Yume gets caught out with a cocoon. They don't take the tower, but they do take it very, very low.
Yeah, that is a dangerous thing here for Modesty. They want to be able to keep that alive, but there's so much push potential from the Vulcan lineup. And of course, they're happy to leave Psycho Sid in this top lane. He will scale harder than Snoy's Shen. So in a way, it does create a bit of pressure. And even though I talked about Ryze early on being important, Karthus scales hard as well. So Mancloud's going to be a big threat. And in the end, you've got to look at, well, you know, Vulcan has one extra high scaling lane. Honestly, it's still on Modesty to make aggressive moves and put pressure on.
A piercing arrow, though, from Exo continuing to find its home. This time onto Zuna, forces him slightly backwards. And Modesty in a bit of a standoff against Vulcan here. Stand United will be up in just a few moments, which is why you see Snoy already heading down to that bottom and starting the split push on Vulcan.
He's going to look for the openings, and always Psycho Sid will be the man sent to counteract it. Those are the only teleporters on the map, so Vulcan has to use that. The only disadvantage, though, for Vulcan is a cooldown disparity, because Snoy is starting to build cooldown reduction. The base cooldown as well on Stand United is shorter than Summoner Teleport, so even though Sid will scale better, Snoy can show up to fights better.
So Infinity Edge still yet to be completed by Snoy. Obviously wants to be the item he's trying to get. It's going to be a long way off it still, because as it stands, 18 minutes into this game, Modesty are now in the gold lead for the first time. They've just passed in towards that gold lead, only ever so slightly though. That turret taking damage in that mid lane, but the got to be careful because it seems when Vulcan want to go, they could easily jump straight on towards him, but it's Mineski forcing them away from that turret.
Yeah, they've got a really good siege team with good poke and good pick potential. If a hook lands from TG, there's a lot of follow-up available for these guys. And Smithy's not really helping to wave clear, so when these minions all fall down, Mineski gets a little bit of time to push that turret out, and then Vulcan has to try to get rid of minions to counteract that.
Can they try and land that cocoon on towards anyone? Smithy tries to get that grab. Exo taking low. He gets the cocoon on him. That should surely be the go sign. Can they catch it towards him? Stranglethorns does manage to bounce three members, but it's Smithy that's trying desperately to back away from this one. Stan United was burnt out from Snoy, and Vulcan successfully hold onto the turret.
And that's a really important cocoon because now Snoy can't easily split push anymore because he has no way of leaving and helping his team. So now he's got to be a lot closer to his team because Vulcan's 4v4 is pretty dang good.
So it does mean that Yume's going to pass across. Vulcan could try and push this one. Remember that middle turret is very, very low, so they could try and catch on towards it. Just put a little bit of poke. That's all it's going to require. And Mineski forced to defend this one while Yume's away farming.
And what's interesting as well is that both these mages have gone for stacking items, and they're still stacking up right now. The Tears turning into Archangel Staffs, the Rod of Ages still building up their stacks as well. So, you know, we're not even done seeing the power of the mid laners. They're going to continue to be more important in this game. But who's important right now is actually Exo. We talked about the Bloodthirster earlier. He's 3-1-3, has a Zeal done as well, whereas Zuna is not even close to finishing Infinity Edge. He can add the Cloak of Agility, but he's still another 600 gold away from finishing Infinity Edge. And that's not even to talk about the Zeal and everything else that has already been added to Exo's inventory. So as far as those two are concerned, Mineski's got a much scarier AD carry.
So it's going to be down, it seems, to Mancloud once again to carry them through. Sid doing a grand job, though. Let's not count him out because he's just been off on his own, farming up that Q, stacking it out heavily. It's already building up. What's he up to so far?
306 right now.
306. So I think he hit 500 plus last time against Fnatic. We'll see how long that continues to develop. But look at Mineski. They're trying to gang up on him.
There's this taunt coming in. It's Kaigu to show up. There's a lot here. Cyclist is going to have a hard time getting out.
He has to use that ghost. Gets fear leashed off. But the rest of the team come in, closing around the side. Exo getting caught out. As we mentioned, he's the man. He's the target. But instead, he puts a good piercing arrow back across onto Sid. Mineski's going to go down, though. Kaigu tries to get down, but he gets away from it. Zuna gets turned around. Has to cleanse off. Taken so low. But that Red Buff's not quite enough to take him down, and he gets away with just about 8 hit points. Spell Shield comes out from Kaigu. Requiem does not find its target.
I'm so surprised Mancloud took so long to use Requiem. They had an opening earlier on in this one, but Zuna with no health at all can't defend a push right here. He needs to recall back.
Bloodwater might get caught out. He's in the corner there with that pink ward. Does manage to clear out that dragon pit. Mineski thinking of going for dragon. This is a bad call, though, because Vulcan are close on by.
The thing is, though, Mancloud has burned all of his major cooldowns, whereas Yume is on Rise. He basically doesn't have any long CDs. The problem is that Smithy is so powerful and can make so many moves by himself.
So I can just say that Zuna actually got out of that fight with 4 hit points. 4 hit points. Vulcan, though, they're going for it. You can see Kaigu coming in. He wants to get the smite steal. It's not going to happen for him. X-Smithy manages to lock it down. Sid comes back in there. He's caught out. And you see the Stranglethorns bouncing Mineski up. Snoy is still yet to get him towards anyone. Instead, it's going to be Vulcan backing away, but Sid's not done yet. Gets Vulcan on towards Kaigu.
Exactly. Vulcan could not fight that battle. Zuna had to go back to base. It was a 4v5. And on top of that, they sent Zuna top lane to go clear out some minions. But because of that, Mineski just turned around for the mid lane. They had people in the right places. And now, Mineski are winning in turrets, only down 500 gold.
You may get a little bit more golden experience for that dragon, but I'd take that mid turret any day of the week. And it seems to be working well for Mineski. Do not rule them out. Could this be the game that they win? They are 7-6 up in kills. They are slightly behind in gold, but they are really giving Vulcan a tough test here. Vulcan, of course, themselves lost earlier on today. Has their confidence been shattered?
It kind of looks like they still don't really look like that sort of top-of-the-world Vulcan squad, the squad that took down Fnatic convincingly, the squad that honestly did great throughout the regular season of the summer split, finished third in the spring split in North America, had a pretty good run overall. This doesn't look quite like them. Zuna finally finishes an Infinity Edge. That's going to be really important for them. Mancloud is powering up the Archangel Staff. It's stacks getting up there. 644, he's almost got Seraphs done, and of course Sego Sid's still scaling up, but it feels like Vulcan are like, shoot, I don't know what to do, let's just go late game.
Yeah, meanwhile, Mineski are going aggressive, but that may actually cost them. You can see they're pushing in. Vulcan immediately react. Snoy is well around the side at the moment, looking to try and go aggressive. Instead, not going to find its target. Kaiku seems to be the man that's always up the front, and he may well have got caught out again. Has the spell shield away. That Lay Waste will finally dodge out the grasping roots from Bloodwater. And instead, Snoy, it's back to that bottom lane.
Yeah, the thing is about the Vulcan's lineup is they don't have that great of catch potential. They've got Wither and like Wall of Pain, and then they hope a Cocoon lands. But they're fighting against Nocturne, they're fighting against Shen, they're fighting against guys who are tanky, have tenacity, spell shields, or ways of getting out of the way. So Vulcan don't really get to set up picks all that much, whereas Mineski is the team with Shen, Nocturne, and Thresh, and Varus. They're really good at picking up these scattered kills away from Vulcan and just gelling together around the map. And now Stand United is up, and Summoner Teleport is not. Again, there's a window for Mineski to make a play.
Vulcan trying to bully out that mid lane. Remember that mid turret? Very, very low. Thought they'd got positional advantage while Mineski tried to ward out that Baron. They managed to get a pink ward in there and clear out Vulcan's ward. So Vulcan have no coverage, really, of that river area right now. So they're going to want to try and get back in and try and gain some vision of that river area. Does see Yume going across towards that top lane, so he's going to be farming up. That's going to give Vulcan a bit of a breather, and it's just going to be these two top laners continuing to battle it out on the bottom.
And the thing is, for the next few minutes, if Mineski wanted to play the Baron dance, they would have Vulcan just sort of in their grasp, because Cid would have to walk across the map to participate in a fight, and not many of the members of Vulcan can really help, like, punch it at Baron or actually fight the guys of Mineski in the Baron pit without walking the long way around and exposing themselves to that Nocturne Shen trap, exposing themselves to counter engage and getting jumped on by Varus, Thresh, and everything. So if Mineski wanted to play a vision game and say, fight us in this jungle while your teleport is down, you'd have an easy fight for the Philippines team.
And while the lane phase, we saw Mancloud building up a big head of steam against Yume. He's been stepping off to the side every time, farming up those waves. And you can see he's actually starting to gain back on towards Mancloud. He's closing that gap. Mancloud himself has been stuck in that mid lane for so long with the rest of his team. He's starting to just feel the pain a little bit in terms of farm.
Yeah, the only lane that's really accelerating for Vulcan is the Nasus lane, Psycho Cid. He's not being pressured much at all. He's 1-0-3. The score is very familiar to the game against Fnatic.
Ooh.
Yes, that was close, but Vulcan go for an opening.
They're going to try and turn it around. Kaigu uses that Paranoia, goes straight back in there. Stranglethorns will bounce a lot of them up. Bloodwall gets away from that. That's a good chain of corruption. Mancloud's going to get focused on, but he's managed to get that damage down. He's going to try and go towards Kaigu. Gets blocked off by Snoy, but it's all to do with the Veil, and he will go down, but that's a jungler for mid laner.
And that's a 2-for-1 without Cid even showing up, and he's about to get a minion wave right in front of this turret. He's going to get this as a prize for his opponent leaving his lane. Cid's going to take another turret down and make it 3-3, and Vulcan don't even have to stop pushing.
No, they don't, but it was a kill nonetheless for Yume, and that's actually going to bounce in terms of gold back towards him, I feel. Tell a lie, he's still 1,000 gold behind Mancloud. You can't stop that man farming.
So Vulcan need to do something with this map lead right now. They picked up a kill. They've got to make something happen because of it. They didn't see the ward in Baron Pit, but Vision is a legitimate reward for... There we go. Vision's a legitimate reward for winning a team fight. It doesn't have to be Dragon, doesn't have to be Baron, doesn't have to be a turret. It's, let's get ward control over Baron so you can't do that dance against us. Or let's get ward control ourselves because Naz has teleport and Shen doesn't.
So 818 kills. You can see it's just 1,000 gold split between these two teams. And this is closing in on the 30-minute mark. Definitely going to be the longest game that either team have had to deal with so far, I feel, in this group, because this is not going to be finishing anytime soon, I believe.
Likely not. Likely not. And Psycho Cid, actually, I like his choice of tank item as well, because you just talk about how the game's not going to end very soon. He didn't buy a Sunfire Cape. He doesn't want minions to die accidentally. He wants to make sure Siphoning Strike gets every last one of them, so he can go infinite and get a fourth digit under a Siphoning Strike that's now over 450. And you gotta keep that in mind. There's this insurance policy for Psycho Cid. Vulcan don't have to do anything except wait.
I think Kaigu just realized, like, yep, I can't keep up with that Cid guy down the bottom lane, but Dragon has spawned. Mineski set themselves up for this one. Vulcan not in any particular position to deal with this one. They're gonna lose out.
But it leaves open Baron is the problem. All five are down there. They have no way of getting across the map easily. Vulcan can start this.
They're going to start it out. You can see Zuna farming it up from the backside. Mithy's going to tank it out on the back there. Mancloud's also with that lay waste. You can see the Psycho Cid. He's teleported up there. They're going to try and take this one down very quick. You can see Mineski there coming up to this one. They realize what is happening. Can they get close enough though? Paranoia is available. He's going to have to go. He's too late. That's going to be Vulcan picking up the Baron. Can they turn the fight around now? Hexmithy taking low. Psycho Sid also getting dropped. He's getting picked off, but he's so tanky. Pops that ghost. He's going to get dropped down. That's one down for Mineski. You see Kaigu and Snoy getting close in there. Mancloud's finally going to close the gap. He's going to have to get it focused on. You can see Stan United on towards him. That's going to be Mancloud going down, but Exo is also going to pay the price. You can see Requiem not going to find his target. Ace in the hole comes in. It was a 2-for-2, but it was Baron for Vulcan.
Uh-oh, but it's Smithy getting caught right here.
He's going to get caught out. It's going to be the damage coming out, but Exo, Zuna comes in. Zuna puts the damage down. Snoy's going to have to try and slide away from this one, but he's not going to make it. Grasping Root comes out. Snoy taking so, so low, but forced away. That's also going to be a turret for Vulcan.
That was an incredible pickup right there. As soon as Mineski came into that fight, I was worried for Vulcan because two of them were in the Baron pit. The other three were on the other side. Watch this come in. Baron comes down. And Sid and Smithy are stuck right here. They're just able to get hit, but Sid takes so long to die that Vulcan can regroup for this fight. And this Stranglethorns does so much early damage that it allows basically this Caitlyn to just shoot for a long time. Mancloud pulls so much attention, but is useful when dead. And so they pick up a kill just from soaking up damage and letting the backline do stuff here for Vulcan. So they go plus one in the fight, they get Baron buff as well. Now Vulcan's the team in the lead, they can start making a siege.
Baron buff still on Zuna, Bloodwater, and I believe Exmithy. Not sure who the other one was. It's still definitely on two. It is on Exmithy. Should never question myself, honestly. So,
never.
Vulcan are ahead. You can see 3k gold lead, ahead in turrets, ahead now in kills. Finally have they turned that corner. Mineski, 0-3, I believe, in this group so far. Almost rank underdogs in this tournament as well. And Vulcan, well, a lot of people have put them for possibly a first or second place finish in this group, and they have to start picking up the wins. And right now, they are really being pressed against it by Mineski.
They are. It's very strange that this game has been so close for Vulcan. You saw how one side of the fan vote was. All the analysts went to them as well. But Mineski, to be fair, have put on a very good show against this. They've been learning quickly. Right, despite how rough some of their games have been, they've put now very good team fights against Fnatic, very good team fights up against Ozone, now a very close game against Vulcan. What happens when they start turning these better and better and start picking up wins? You've got to feel a good sense of pride for Mineski, how quickly they're improving in their games here. And Snoy, on this split push, no teleports here for Vulcan, so again, you get room here with Shen to make moves.
He's going to be taking that turret down, that's for sure. So it's a trade, inner turret for inner turret. Vulcan catching Mineski a little bit out of position on that top lane, but Snoy definitely sneaking in there. That's going to be the turret gain. He's going to back off. You can see Vulcan trying to collapse in, and this is actually wasting time on that Baron. I mean, they've taken that top turret, sure enough, but Danny's going to be all.
Yeah, it's sort of like an Ozone-style late game. This is looking at them from the summer season, but it's going to be Manclap. No, okay, he's got out.
He's got out. Kaigu using that Paranoia. Smithy actually missing out on towards the Cocoon there. He may get focused on. There's going to be Chain of Corruption landed on towards him, but they're having to back out. Stranglethorns popping Mineski back there, and now Kaigu's in trouble. He's got that Oracle on, but he may not last because Smithy's going to pounce on towards him. He does survive. Ace in the hole comes out. TG catches that one. Uses the box randomly. The Requiem comes through. That's going to find a double kill, and now Snoy's in trouble. He gets focused down. Finally, Vulcan starting to turn the screws on the Philippine team, and it's going to be Yume backing off. Exo gets caught out. Wither comes in. Vulcan closing the door. They do manage to get one. Yume's not going to be able to survive another, though, and that will be the ace for Vulcan. When they finally land it, it's Xmidi that closes it out. It's a 5-for-1.
That's a well-played team fight for Vulcan. It'll give them a lot of Mineski's base, if not the whole thing, and I've got to wonder why Mineski wanted to start a fight against the team with Baron buff, who's winning in goals. We'd seen them team fight pretty well. They pulled a bunch back. That one seemed a little bit over-eager, and you saw Vulcan really just destroy that battle.
And this is maybe just the experience selling there, the fact that obviously Vulcan have been in the LCS in North America, up against the top teams in America for the last year.
Yeah, so watch the start of this fight. A lot of burst goes down on the tanks on both sides. What changes this battle here is actually the persistent damage of the backline. Compare Yume to Mancloud. Compare Zuna to Exo. Exo's running around and the backline's not able to do much. While Zuna gets more or less free range to channel his ultimate, put shots down onto Snoy. Exo's still running around doing nothing. Requiem's, of course, an easy kill pickup. And the entire time, Yume's not doing much except now running away. Nasa's tanking these two guys. But with Wither, it's just easy to chase guys down. Mancloud gets to follow up as well. And it's because the damage dealers got to keep dealing damage. That actually meant a lot in this fight.
Yeah, you see Yume, he managed to pick up that one and only kill on towards Sid, but frankly, the damage was done. The Wither was down, and Nexo was not getting out of that one. So blue buff goes across to Mancloud. Mancloud himself picked up that double kill, of course, and that stretched him out in those items. Void Staff was completed. Rod of Ages also stacked in there, which was a long time ago, sorry. What I'm talking about is the Needlessly Large Rod he's just picked up as well. Meanwhile, he is a big difference in gold. And you were talking about earlier, Zuna was falling behind in items. He's actually just turned it and completely caught up now because of those kills that he picked up.
Yeah, he's got a 500 gold lead. A lot of that comes from the global advantage, especially from Vulcan. But also, yes, he's finally getting some kills under his belt. Just barely eclipsing now Exo, who had started 3-1-3, has done much worse since then. Vulcan grabbing another global objective, getting their whole team now in the lead, and it's Vulcan looking to basically close the game out. It's a secured end game. They're taking their time, grabbing objectives, making sure that they do everything by the book and don't overdive and give comeback potential here, because we've seen how well Mineski can team fight. You might even see them go for Baron again, set the wards back up, and close it out. A good while from now.
Well, Sid stealing away the golem, every little counts, but meanwhile, the rest of the Vulcan are backing in towards that mid lane. Remember, it's super minions pushing down there. They're going to try and buy themselves a positional advantage, try and push that top and bottom mid lane.
And the siege is still happening. Yeah! Top, bottom, and mid. All three. They're pushing them all.
I don't know where mid came from there.
The super minions. That's exactly where they were going.
Where they were going.
Yeah. But the top lane is getting sieged down. Sid has good turret pressure here. Snoy, though, it will sweep away minions decently. This is a catch here on a Smithy. This might be good.
Nick Smithy repels away, catches on towards it. TG taken low. Standing Knight are going to be used, but it's not enough. Teleport comes in. Psycho Sid's about to join the party. Jumps on towards a Yume. Yume taken very low from this one. Psycho Sid does manage to get Room Prisoned up there. They're trying to get away from this one. That's going to be Exo going down in the backside to Mancloud. Meanwhile, Psycho Sid romps on through the roll base, and that surely will be the game for Vulcan.
Super minions hitting the Nexus. This will be Vulcan finally getting a much needed win at the end, the end of the day for this team, making them back to 2-2. And the crowd chanting USA in the background, happy to have their hometown team pick up a win right here. Hard fought victory, but Vulcan's done it.
Absolutely. So, Vulcan, they finally close out the win. It took them a time, that's for sure. 35 minutes, it was not an easy win by any account. Mineski certainly put up a very valiant performance this time around. But Vulcan finally, after the fans and all the analysis claimed they would take the victory, they certainly did, but it took them a long time.
Yeah, plus one win for the analyst, plus one win for the home audience, and plus one win for these guys. Mineski, I would not hang your head low if I were them, though. They put on a good fight. Couple of miscues, sure, but I think their team comp looked pretty good. I think they had a pretty obvious goal there, and they executed it reasonably well. But a couple of good picks by the Vulcan squad, a couple of rough team fights, but they've been learning. They said they came in here to learn. They're doing better and better each game. I think there's still a team that could take some wins here by the end of the tournament. Each team plays each other team twice.
Well, that's for sure, but you've got to look at Vulcan on the other hand after that performance. That was not a confident performance by any stretch of the imagination. They struggled there. You know, when you're looking at the rest of the group with Fnatic, Gambit, and Samsung Galaxy Ozone all ahead of them so far, that was not a performance you think they're going to take it by storm.
Yeah, and even though Vulcan did take down Fnatic, Fnatic immediately said, like, yeah, we really screwed up in Champion Select there. We didn't play our game. And you compare Fnatic in that game to the rest of Fnatic's games, and that squad looked a whole lot better. So, Vulcan, if they turn it around, again, you're playing another six games throughout. You're going to play a couple more here. There's still a good chance for these guys to turn it back around, do a good job, and get themselves where they need to be.
Well, we'll see exactly what they do later on in the week. So for now, we are going to send it over to Quickshot and the analysis.
Sounds
guys,
like a band
which
name.
I think it could be a band game, of course, but I think it would be a really cool band name for a breakdown of Game 4.
I don't think D-Man is convinced that's a cool band name. He's not really in love with the idea.
That's okay. Freak's got good style sense. Yeah, nice shirt.
So first of all, congratulations for Vulcan. They picked themselves up a win. Definitely hard fought by. I don't think we can discount Mineski's performance in this particular game. But we'll get to that in a second. Let's go back to the picks and bans. One of the things that stood out during this pick ban phase was that Vulcan, they had a lot of sort of champions that would scale well into the late game, and there was a fair amount of global. We actually seen Twisted Fate was hovered over before the Ryze was locked in. So Mineski, they were thinking about that Shen TF Nocturne and decided against it.
I actually would have preferred them to do that. I mean, they would have been lacking a bit in the damage, but when they saw the Karthus come out there, I think that says, I mean, I think this is the first time we've seen Karthus so far in this tournament, but that says really that Vulcan doesn't have a lot of confidence in Mineski's ability to close the game early, which has been a problem and why we haven't seen very many Karthus picks here. But if they went all in with the Twisted Fate, I think they could have maybe applied even more pressure. They had some nice plays in the mid game, though, all the same.
In terms of the performances we've seen from Mineski thus far, this is definitely their strongest game. I mean, think about Fnatic. Fnatic had them against the ropes at 16, 17 minutes. Then they still scrapped for another 10. Ozone struggled to close it out. They were aced a couple times trying to push into their bases. And now, you know, Mineski were basically trading blow for blow with Vulcan up until the 25-minute mark where some of the fights didn't go their way. What did you think of the game as it played out, Doublelift?
Yeah, definitely. I think Mineski fell behind early game by a decent amount, but they came back in a dragon fight where it was really unexpected that they would outplay Vulcan that way. But as the game went on, Vulcan just proved more experience, maybe a little better mechanically. And their team fighting, both the team comps were very good at team fighting, I feel. And when the team fights would just start up, I feel like Vulcan just outplayed them a little bit, enough so that they would just pull out a little bit more in the team fights.
Problem basically is with the Karthus as well. Early game, you can try and kill him and then initiate, and then go away from him and walk back as he ulties, reset the fight. Later in the game, you saw actually Mandatory Cloud getting a little tankier, having a little more damage, being more of a threat. They could no longer just kill Karthus and move out, and he just kept ruining the fights. Even if they managed to run away from him, the ulti came down and finished people off.
I want to bring it back, too, to something that I believe you were saying earlier, Doublelift, about Zuna being a playmaking AD carry. And I think we can see what a double-edged sword that was that game. Sometimes he'd flash right in and end up melting. Uh-huh. Sometimes he'd flash in and pick up kills. We really saw both.
I mean,
both
he flashed
angles
into melee range to finish off two kills at the end there. So sometimes it does work out.
You're Caitlyn, that's what you do, right?
Exactly.
He did get away the first flash with 4 HP in dramatic style. Let's talk a little bit about what this means. Now, of course, Mineski, they're sitting at the bottom of the table. The games are improving as the tournament goes on. And there's two things I want to highlight. That if Mineski do manage to pick up a victory against anybody once they continue playing, it makes a life for that team even more difficult if they want to make it into the playoffs. Secondly, for a team like Vulcan, who convincingly beat Fnatic, and now, I don't want to use the word struggle, but they scrapped to pick up this win, you know, as it went on. How do you think Vulcan will be taking this one psychologically?
I mean, they definitely look like they're having a hard time today in general already, with this win and the earlier loss. I know, Krepo, you felt strongly about it.
Yeah, I don't know if it's part of their composition, but it just really felt like, yeah, they were struggling a bit. They just weren't the same Vulcan that really beat Fnatic. They weren't as confident. They weren't the Vulcan that was getting all those early leads. I can't but feel like it's my fault. Ever since I started supporting them, they've been doing poorly. It's like I'm cursed.
The EG curse, dude. Yeah.
Oh,
EG curse.
Oh, no.
Oh, wow.
Scumbag Krepo, indeed. So, you know, another victory picked up for Vulcan. There is one more game coming today. So, let's actually start to move this one along. Take a look at how the standings are looking for Group B. Because now, of course, Vulcan will be bumping themselves up to 2-2 to tie themselves with Ozone, who are currently sitting at 2-2 as well. So the middle of the pack, almost as tight as a European LCS. Not quite.